Hey guys, welcome back to my channel Insane Med. This is Supreeta. I'm a third year medical student in BGS Medical College, Bangalore, India. In today's video, I'm going to be talking to you guys about how to present your answers effectively in your theory exams. I have already made a video about this topic and you guys seem to love it. So this is more of like a second part of that video where I'm going to cover some of the things that I was not able to cover in that video. Before I start the video, I just want to give you guys a disclaimer that I'm neither a teacher nor an examiner. I am just a student. I just hope that these tips will help you in improving your presentation in the exams. I'm going to provide timestamps for everything that I'm talking about in the video. So feel free to skip around or go to the particular chapter that you want to go to. So without further ado, let's get started. Putting a plan for yourself is very important even before you start attempting the exam. So make sure that you're allotting time for each specific main. Usually all exams that I know of have two long answers and 10 short essays and 10 short answers. I usually like to start from either short answers or short essays, and I have explained in my other video about why I do this in detail, but to be very brief here, it is just to save time. If you start with 10 markers, you'll end up losing a lot of time and 80 marks is going to be at stake. So it is better to start from 5 markers or 3 markers and finish a major portion of your writing and then come to 10 markers. So I usually give only around 1 hour 15 minutes for 5 markers, 45 minutes to 60 minutes for the 3 markers, and then around 40 to 60 minutes for my 10 markers. Now when it comes to structuring your answer as such, I am going to outline a few important points about each division. So you should definitely always start with a definition of whatever they have given. If it's a disease, explain briefly about what the disease is. If it is a test, give a definition of what that test is going to do. And most of the times, whatever definition you are writing should be word to word from the textbook. I know it is very hard to remember all the definitions as it is given in the textbook, but as far as you can, try to write the definitions as they are given in the textbook, because these definitions are usually given by organizations and associations like World Health Organization or Cardiology Association, and each word in the definition has a particular purpose and a particular meaning. So you cannot miss these words. As far as you can, try to write the definitions as they are given in the textbook, or else there might be chances that you will end up losing marks for your definitions. Coming to normal values. So usually in every answer, it is better to include the normal parameters, even if it is a pathology answer that you are writing. Even if it is something abnormal that you are writing, you should be able to write the normal values and say that if these parameters are not met, that is when this pathology is going to be seen. And then the next part should be to divide your answers into various headings and subheadings. And usually the pattern that everybody follows and is expected to follow is whenever you are given a disease, it is basically important to divide it into etiology, pathogenesis, clinical features or signs and symptoms, differential diagnosis and treatment. So if you're able to put down these headings and write some points in each of these headings, then you will definitely get a lot of marks. Whatever subject you are writing, make sure that you're able to put down a lot of relevant headings and subheadings. And obviously, to get an idea about these headings and subheadings, your textbooks are going to be the best source. If I have to show you guys an example, see, this is my ENT answer where I had to write about atrophic rhinitis. So the first thing you do is start with an explanation about what the disease is, and then you go to the etiology. What is the causative organism? And then if there is a classification, give the classification, primary and secondary, and write points about it. The next thing is going to be pathogenesis. Here I've written this in the form of 2 points or a small paragraph, but what is even going to be better is if you're able to put a flowchart or a diagram for this along with the explanation. Okay, I did not have time to write it and I was in a hurry, so that is why I have written it like this, but it is always going to be better if you're able to put down a diagram or a flowchart. And the next thing to write is the clinical features. And even when you're writing the clinical features, if you're able to put them in points like this, it is even more better. Okay, so put them in the form of points. And last but not the least, you are going to write the treatment. So one more thing I have forgotten to add here is the differential diagnosis. If you write the differential diagnosis, again you're going to get a lot more marks. So whenever you're writing your answers, try to structure it in this way. And next, coming to the most important points that will fetch you a lot more marks when you're writing an answer, is going to be writing if there are any clinical applications, especially if you are in first year. For every answer, try to include clinical applications. Try to include a lot of diagrams. Try to include a lot of flowcharts. These are going to fetch you a lot of marks, okay? Now, before I get into the next topic of how much you should write and what is important to write for each subject, I want to clear a few minor details or minor doubts that you guys might have. So the first thing is, whenever you are drawing your diagrams, a lot of you asked me whether you should use color pencils or pens. See, for us in RGHS University, in first year, we were not allowed to use color pencils. So we just drew all our diagrams in pen and not in pencil, because your answer sheets are going to be scanned. For us, we were not allowed to use color pencils. If you're allowed to use, maybe you can use color pencils, but I wouldn't suggest using color pencils except H&E, because you will probably end up wasting a lot of time in drawing all those arteries and veins in different colored pencils. And the next thing is, when you are writing your answers, make sure that you're not writing anything in the margins. This is again because your exam papers are going to be scanned, and there are high chances that the margins or the edges can get cut off. So even though you have written things, you might not get marks. So whatever answer you're going to write, make sure you're writing it within the allotted pages. Now, coming to the next point of how many pages should you write or how much should you write for each answer, let's start with 3 markers and then go to 5 markers and 10 markers. See, if I have to be honest, how much you have to write is going to be very subjective. It is going to probably depend on the type of examiner that is going to correct your paper. But most of the times, the marks you're going to get is going to depend on the quality of your answers and definitely not on the quantity of your answers. I have seen a lot of people say that the marks you're going to get is going to be proportional to the number of pages you write. That is absolutely wrong. If you're going to write pages and paragraphs together without getting to the point, you will get 0 marks. So, first of all, let's start with 3 markers. Now, for us in second year, what our university did was they had allotted pages for each answer specifically with question numbers, okay? So all of these things that I'm going to be telling is going to be based on that. What they had done was they had given us only one side of the page for 3 markers, okay? They had allotted only one side of the page for 3 markers, not even one page. So we had specific question numbers written there and we had to write answers only in that page. So this evidently means that for a 3 marker, you need not write more than one side of the page. That is only this much, okay? You don't have to write front and back for 3 markers. And there are a few points that you have to keep in mind when you're writing 3 markers. That is, number one, when they have asked you a diagram, sometimes they'll just give you write the diagram of maybe tympanic membrane. Then make sure that you try to include at least 6 important namings in the diagram, because I have usually seen, and my professors also most of the times tell, that for 3 markers, usually each naming is going to carry half marks. And even if they're asking difference between something, try to include 6 points, okay? This might not always be true, but usually each point is going to be given half marks, okay? So for 3 markers, only one side of the page is enough. This is not my opinion. This is what was given for us in our RGUHS University final exam. Only one side of the page was allotted for 3 markers. So I don't think you need to write more than that, okay? And then for 5 markers. Under 5 markers, we were allotted 5 sides of the pages. In the sense, 2.5 pages. So that's going to be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? Out of that, I was able to attempt or write at most 4 sides or 3 sides for most of my answers. Now, why I'm saying this is because most of the times, you will not have time trying to fill all the 5 pages, and you don't have to fall behind filling all 5 sides of the pages. I essentially wrote only 3 sides of the pages or 4 sides of the pages for most of my 5 markers, and I still ended up scoring a distinction in all 4 of my subjects. So I think writing that much for 5 markers is enough. And again, this is what was allotted to us by RGHS University itself. And then when it comes to 10 markers, we were, I think, allotted around 6 or 7 sides. Okay, that essentially means we were allotted around 3 or 4 pages. Okay, and I was able to write around 6 sides, that is 3 pages, that's all. And you guys might think that, you know, it is very less. How can you write only 3 pages for a 10 marker? But again, as I said, it is going to be the quality of your answers and not at all the quantity of your answers that is going to matter. But there is a very thin line between, you know, these two opinions, and that is, if you write only 1 page for a 10 marker, you're obviously not going to get marks, because there is some amount of pages that is expected for each answer. Okay, so you have to keep that in mind. Coming to the important points that I think you should be including in the answers for each subject that will hopefully fetch you more marks is as follows. So for anatomy, the most important thing you should be including is diagrams. Diagrams and applied anatomy. If you include these two things, you will get a lot of marks. In physiology, flowcharts, diagrams and applied physiology, and also normal values for things. Okay, and then when it comes to biochemistry, the most important thing is going to be, again, normal values of things like urea or creatinine, and cycles and enzymes are very, very important in biochemistry. So you have to pay a lot of attention to these things when you're writing an answer. The 3 first year subjects, applied aspect is very, very important. Nobody is going to ask you in the question, but you have to mention it, and if you mention it, you will get a lot of marks. For second years, for pathology, the most important thing is going to be to include your H&D diagrams. Even in anatomy, your H&D diagrams are very, very important. Your histology diagrams. In pathology, your histopathology diagrams, your normal structural diagrams, diagnostic tests if there are present for the particular diseases, and also specific markers in pathology. For example, if there is a tumor, if you're able to mention the specific marker like alpha fetoprotein or HCG, that will give you marks. If you're able to mention the specific diagnostic test that is used for that disease, that will fetch you marks. Coming to microbiology. In microbiology, culture medium is going to be very important, because for each organism, there are specific culture mediums, special culture mediums that you have to remember. And you have to remember the treatments that is going to be given for that particular disease. Especially in microbiology, if you're mentioning the treatment for the disease, you will get a lot of marks. And also, special stains are very important. For example, Albert stain, okay? Things like that. If you can mention these special stains, special diagnostic tests like VIDAL or VDRL, there are these important things, if you're able to mention, then you'll get a lot of marks. When it comes to pharmacology, in pharmacology, the most important thing will be to write down the mechanism of action, the class of the drug, and specific side effects. For every drug, there's going to be a specific side effect that you'll have to remember, okay? And also, if there are special routes of administration, that also you should be mentioning. You cannot probably remember all the routes of administration and volume of distribution for all drugs, but for some drugs, you will have to remember them. For example, in beta blockers, esmolol is the only beta blocker that can be given intravenously. All of the others are going to be given orally. Okay, so that is why you can use esmolol in emergency conditions. So things like this, if there is one particular drug which does not belong to the general characteristics of that class of drugs, then you have to pay attention to them. When it comes to forensic medicine, for forensic medicine, the most important thing is going to be the definitions, okay? Especially the definitions which have sections like IPC, CRPC, they are very, very important, Okay, you have to learn them word by word. And if you are able to mention the particular sections, you are going to get a lot of marks. And you should also be able to mention the medico-legal importance of whatever they have given. I have tried to cover a lot of things in this video. If there are things in which you still have doubt, definitely ask me in the comment section below, or you can message me on my Instagram and I will definitely try to reply back to you guys. So I hope that these tips were helpful to you guys, and thank you for watching. Have a nice day.